They are not going, we are not going to pass the same question back and forth. It's not going to be a presidential debate. We don't have 4 hours. So what we will do, it's kind of like we did in the SPLOST debate. They have 2 minutes to answer the question. If they answer that question quicker, then they can use their time, the remaining time, any way they like to. They can challenge an answer. They can add on to a previous question that they were asked. They can save that time for another question. Okay, so we're trying to keep it to 2 minutes. Do the math on that. I mean, hopefully we can get 30 or 40 questions through here. Okay, you were all given a packet. We had 10 questions that our leadership group came up with for each candidate. We sent that out about 4 days in advance to them and asked them to complete that, so you have their answers there in front of you. We thought those were kind of general questions, and we didn't want to take up asking each one of those questions to all three of them. That would have been another 30 questions, so that would have taken another hour. So we wanted to make that as quick as possible, so we just put them in print, some pretty good answers. And I hope that you guys will find this very informative. The sheriff's budget is a very, very big part of the county budget. It's a very important position, and we need a good qualified candidate. And I think all three of these guys each have something unique to bring to the table. So with that, we're going to start with our prayer. Ralph.
This prayer was taken from a prayer said at the First Continental Congress, September the 7th, 1774, at 9 o'clock in the morning. Please join me. Our Lord, our Heavenly Father, look down in mercy, we beseech thee. Be thou present, O God of wisdom, and direct the counsels of this honorable assembly. Enable them to settle things on the best and surest foundation, that order, harmony, and peace may be effectually restored. May truth and justice prevail and flourish amongst the people. All this we ask in the name and through the merits of Jesus Christ, thy Son and our Savior. And they all said,
Amen.
And if you'll stand up, we'll say the pledge. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And if you have questions, hold them up now. We'll come around and pick those up. Candidates, we're going to pass the mic to you, so you can sit and answer or stand and answer. It's up to you. We'll bring it to you. We've got all this stuff set up up here, so I think it'd be easier just to bring it up. I know you like the book.
Thanks a lot, Steve. All right, gentlemen, you know, Steve mentioned you'll have a 5-minute introduction. A little bit more along the lines of housekeeping here. I will be keeping time. So as he mentioned, it's going to be a 2-minute limit on each question. At the minute 30 mark, I'll hold up a green card so that you know that you know where you are with time. And then at a minute 50, I'll hold up a red card. And finally, at 2 minutes, we'll ring the bell. So we ask that you keep to the time limit so that we can keep things moving. Okay. I'm just going to go in the order that we have gentlemen here. So.
Good evening. I'm Laura McDonald III, and I want to be your sheriff of Forsyth County. I'm excited about this unique opportunity to run for sheriff, not as someone that has 25 years of law enforcement experience, but as someone who runs a business and manages people. You, the citizens, allow me this opportunity because anyone in this room could be doing what I'm doing today. The laws allow for ethical and moral people the opportunity because anyone could be running for sheriff. The people of Georgia could could have empowered our legislature to change the law to only allow those that have law enforcement experience if they thought it would be best for the citizens of Georgia. Today, the law allows for a businessman to offer himself to manage an office that has a budget of over $38 million and a staff of over 370 deputies and other employees. I'm a third-generation firefighter, with both my grandfather as an assistant chief and my dad as a chief for 25 years. I am proud of my 24 years in public safety as a fireman and my 11 years as your coroner. Like many of you, I chose to move to Forsyth County and invest in my future in starting a successful business. My greatest accomplishment is my family. My wife Claire and I have two boys in Forsyth County school system, one in second grade and one in third grade. And we have a daughter who will start in 1 year. They are the big reason why I'm standing in front of you today. From my early years in scouting to an elected position by my peers as captain of Station 1 during the volunteer days of Forsyth County, my friends and colleagues have chosen me to lead them and make life-challenging decisions for the betterment of all involved. Since then, you have elected me 3 times as your coroner. In the past 11 years, I've learned a lot about the investigative science of death as coroner. I've experienced our traffic issues, not only because of congestion, but what happens when there is a wreck or fatality and the citizen sits stagnant on the road. I will have a plan. Over the past 15 years, Forsyth County has doubled in size. As the population was continuing, the Office of Sheriff's budget went in almost a vertical climb. It is now 41% of our total operating of our net budget of our $92 million. There are 41 other departments in Forsyth County that have to share the other 59%. As your sheriff, I promise to reduce the budget, but not the service and protection that should be provided to each one of you. A clear and transparent view of the budget and drug seizure funds will be available through a 9-member Sheriff's Council. This citizens group of men and women will assist in budget decision and personnel recommendations. This will in turn make for a more efficient office. This is going to be a priority. I want to work with our county manager and commissioners so that the reduction of the sheriff's budget could go to the reduction of debt in our county. As my first priority is the reduction of the overall budget of their office, the top priority is to ensure the safety of our 37,626 kids in our schools. With only 7 school resource officers working in our system, our children and our teachers are vulnerable. Our school system is paying half of the salaries of these officers to have our children and our teachers protected. The presence of our deputies is a deterrent for the possibilities of wrongdoing. Our deputies need to be role models for our kids and provide education about drugs, alcohol, gangs, and cyber crimes. Our drug seizure funds that exist should be infused in such programs instead of buying non-essential vehicles. I promise to increase the presence of the resource program to not only educate the kids, but the parents as well. Parents need to know what's going on in the cyber world, and the choices our children make today can affect their lives for eternity. It is the responsibility of the sheriff to protect these kids and teachers. I, along with the deputies, will work with our educators in Forsyth County to give these kids the best possible chance for success. A sheriff's office can only be as good as its deputies. A sheriff needs to be someone who has the mutual respect and trust of the deputies. I promise to work towards better pay for the deputies. A clear and defined career path will be established for both certified officers and non-certified as well. Retention of our deputies is going to be one of the most important things. We will keep a strong civil service section of the office and place some of the most knowledgeable deputies to complete these duties. The jail will not be a place for punishment for deputies, but a place that one will want to begin and finish his career. I will restore the feeling and pride of being a Forsyth County deputy and what the true meaning of protecting and serving is all about. It's time to bring the budget down and the morale up. To accomplish these goals, I'm going to need the trust of you, the citizens of Forsyth County. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Everybody hear me okay? Thank you. I'm Ted Paxton. It's been my honor and pleasure to be your sheriff for the last 11 plus years. Over those 11 years, is correct, we have seen a tremendous amount of growth in population in Forsyth County. But we've also responded to that growth. We've been able, with the economic downturn over the last several years, to still maintain a tremendous impact on crime in Forsyth County. We've been able to drive crime down. Crime stats are down. We've been able, during that period of time, to bring to the forefront new technology never seen before in law enforcement in Forsyth County. From the time I took office today, where we have come to in the availability of technology and what the deputies have at their fingertips out there in the field to be able to do their job. The creation of our own training division, dedicated to make sure that we keep them on the cutting edge of everything that has to do with the effective enforcement of law in Forsyth County. Mr. McDonald's right. We do have a lot of programs just like he's talking about. Great programs. I agree with him. Yes, we do have deputies in the school system, and yes, they do pay for the salaries, and it's not 50%, it's 70%. That's how much they're in the schools. That's the trade-off that the school system wants. We work in conjunction with them. What type of presence, police presence, do they want in the schools? I'm not going to dictate it to them, but we're there to provide the level of service which they want. It's been my pleasure to serve you for the last 11 plus years. We still got a lot of work to do, a lot of things to do. I look forward to continue to serve as your sheriff. Remember this, bottom line, what does the sheriff do? He enforces the law. He serves the courts, and he operates the county jail. I stand on my record. I'm steadfastly proud of the record, what we have done here in Forsyth County, and I look forward to continue to serve you in this capacity. Thank y'all.
Thank you all for being here. I'd ask one thing of everybody in this room. Please maintain this level of interest in your local government and your local elections throughout this election cycle. Do exactly what we're doing here tonight. Come meet your candidates, get to know what they're about, what they'll do. Ask them questions, ask them hard questions. Are they running for office because they want to fulfill the constitutional imperatives of what the office is for? Or are they running for a political position? Hundreds of years ago, when the U.S. Constitution and our state constitution were written, it was written by men who were creating a government for two purposes: maintain order and to provide for the overall security of the people, of the citizenry. Every position was created for a specific purpose. The office of sheriff is a constitutional position. It has some specific constitutional responsibilities. Are your candidates running for the reasons of fulfilling those responsibilities, or is it a political position? What happens when your government gets out of control? Your budget goes up. The budgets go up, taxes go up. Nothing good can come of that. We have several metro Atlanta areas where their budgets have gotten out of control. Gwinnett, DeKalb, Fulton. We have chaos. We have escalating taxes. Escalating taxes hurt every one of us. They don't hurt us all equally. There's groups of people, specifically people on fixed incomes, our senior citizens, and our disabled folks. You had $25, $50, $100 a month to their taxes, that impacts their life. Not their lifestyle, that impacts their life. That's not a couple times a month they can't go out to eat. That's groceries that they can't buy. That's medication that they won't be able to buy. I'm not gonna be part of raising the taxes. I'm not gonna be part of raising your taxes. Mr. McDonald did a good job of outlining a lot of the things I've been talking about for the last several months. The budget's got to be cut, but we cannot and we will not do that at the expense of the outstanding law enforcement the people in Forsyth County expect and deserve. We can actually improve what we're doing. We have an example of the east of us and the west of us, a couple of comparatives. Cherokee County and Hall County, both of them operate much larger agencies than we have. They have bigger jails already, and they also have more police officers on the streets. Yet they're both doing it for millions of dollars less than we're doing it here in Forsyth County. It can be done, and we don't need to cut your services. We don't need to cut the quality of what we're doing for you, and we won't. Once again, please pay attention to what your candidates are saying. Look at the forms we filled out. I'm not going to try to cover everything on those. Look at the forms we filled out. Ask us the hard questions. Make sure where we're standing. Thank you.
We got a lot of people in the doorway. We got room in the back. We've got room over here on the side. Y'all will clear that. Keep coming in. We've got room where you can hear a lot better and see a lot better. You guys would all slide down. I feel like I'm in church here. We will be passing the money jar around later. Yeah, I'm not kidding. We have to rent the room, so it's going around at some point. Come on in, John. Come on in.
Yeah, and to reiterate what Steve said, you know, donations are what help us rent these rooms and create flyers and get information out to everybody. So that helps us continue doing what we're doing here. All right, so gentlemen, we're going to start with the questions. I'm going to have a question for each of you. We're going to continue to work down the line. There's a two-minute time limit on the answers, and any rebuttals need to come out of the 2 minutes that you have for whatever question that you have at that time. Okay. All right. The first one's going to be for Sheriff Paxton. The question is, how are the drug seizure funds transparent to citizens or employees as stated in your campaign literature? And where is the audit?
There's been a lot of talk about the drug seizure fund. First of all, annually, all expenses, all things done with the drug seizure fund has to be turned into a report to the Board of Commissioners. It is reviewed there. The chairman of the Board of Commissioners then signs off on the report. It is then transmitted to the United States Department of Justice, who then goes over it for scrutiny to make sure all expenditures are in line with the guidelines set forth by Congress of how the funds are to be spent. Yes, we do have a drug seizure fund. I have made all appropriate expenses out of that fund during my administration. We have, in fact, over the last 11 years, purchased, as a lot of people like to talk about, 103 vehicles, 81 of which today are still in service throughout the entire fleet of the Sheriff's Office. Vehicles paid for with drug seizure money, not tax dollars. And where we are at today with the way revenues have gone down, thank God we have had that to be able to work with and operate on. And I have failed to see how the appropriate spending of the money in the drug seizure fund is a bad thing. I don't understand that. It is done, once again, by strict guidelines issued by the Department of Justice. The transparency also comes in the fact that every year, the county hires outside auditors to come in and audit every account throughout the county, including every sheriff's office account. Yes, it's a good idea that they be accounted for, and it's done already. Thank y'all so much.
All right, the second question is for Duane Piper. Since both of you have a common term in office, have either of you seen or have personal knowledge of the administration or Lieutenant Piper doing something illegal or inappropriate.
Question for me?
No. That's fine. All right, this one's for Lauren. What would qualify you to be the ultimate decision maker in a hostage situation when SWAT is called out?
Unfortunately, that would be something you'd hate to be in that situation, that you would have to ultimately make the decision on whether someone lives or dies. In my life, I've been put in those situations, being a medic and being a fireman. I mean, I've been inside of wrecks that I've had to make a decision on which patient to take out first, and of course, it is tough. And of course, sometimes the decision it may not be the best, but you employ a good number two man to assist you when you're making these tough decisions. That y'all can make decisions together, and hopefully that you know you won't ever be put in that position.
Thank you.
All right, Sheriff Paxton. Have any of you used taxpayer money or campaign money for personal use?
No.
All right, Duane, the next question's yours. Explain your concept of budget preparation and staying within it. You hear me?
Budget preparation. We're gonna go to zero-based budgeting. Some business folks in here, a lot of business folks that I already know are in here. Zero-based budgeting is a concept where you're not basing anything on your budget, on what you did the previous year, what you've ever done before. You're basing it on the situation, the crime rates, and the things that are going on right then, and you're basing it on what you're going to need for the next year. You may be cutting a good bit. Actually, we will be, especially for the first few years. We'll be cutting a good bit. Zero-based budgeting. Everybody understand that? That's my concept. How do we stay in it? We do what we say. We say we're going to do this. That's what we do. If we cut it under, more creative thinking, better work. I'm sorry, I was a little bit flip with my first answer. I apologize for that. Am I allowed to ask, if someone wants to clarify what that question was, I'd be glad to answer more of it.
Well,
you don't want me to do that?
Yeah, I mean, the question was, you know,
how much longer do we have?
You've got a minute.
Okay, never mind then.
Well, the question is, have you ever seen or witnessed any misuse of funds or anything illegal?
Okay, I'm sorry. No. But let me go back to something Mr. McDonald just said. This may be the only thing that Sheriff Paxton and I agree on this entire campaign. Mr. McDonald doesn't seem to understand that some of the most important and the most difficult decisions that he's going to make, if he's elected sheriff, he has to make on his own. The sheriff makes some very important decisions at very difficult times. If you don't have the experience to draw on to make those types of decisions, you've got the wrong guy in the job. This is what I was talking about in my opening statements. Look at who's running for office. Why are they running for office? Make sure they know what they're doing before you vote for them. Thank you.
Any more questions? Raise your hand if you do.
Yeah, you know, we're still taking questions, so feel free to write them in and hand them up front here. All right, Lauren. Other than coroner, what other qualifications do you have to be sheriff?
The qualifications for being sheriff is basically managing people and manage a budget. I mean, you look at the budget of $38 million, you establish an office that has great number two staff members and that people can lead your office. And as a businessman, I feel that I would be best to operate the budget of the sheriff's office and manage the people within.
Thank you. All right, the next one is for Sheriff Paxton. Do we really need a horse ranch owned by the sheriff's department?
When you're running an agency, you're looking at everything you can do to make, number one, a positive impact on the community, and every asset and resource you can use to establish some measure of fighting crime. Now, yeah, we do have a mounted unit. We got four horses. Last year, 2011, the amount of the budget dollars in our budget spent on that program was $11,000. The rest of it is operated through donations and from there. Now, they have provided over the years vital service. We are responsible for policing, regardless of what you may think, all the parks on this side of the lake in Lake Lanier. So during the season, on the weekends, from Memorial Day to Labor Day, they are out there on the horses, and they're out there patrolling. When we have particular events, particular things that may occur that we can utilize them, we do. A couple of months ago, we had an incident down at the avenues of Forsyth. I'm sure you're all familiar with that place. And on the weekends, we have a lot of teenagers that congregate down there. And we had an event down there where there was a robbery actually occurred, an armed robbery of one of those teenagers. So for the next month or so, on every Friday and Saturday evening, we had them out there. Not only did they make an impact on that, but the payoff that you get from that positive interaction just by using those animals and being present out there, they're constantly being walked up to by families with their children, wanting to see the horses, wanting to talk to the deputies, listen to their stories, to interact with them. Well, you know what? The positive influence that interaction is going to have on those children with that deputy down the road is worth every penny that's ever been invested in that program. Thank you.
All right, Duane, the next question is yours. Explain your concept. Oh, wait. Sorry. One second. All right, this is actually a question for all three. So we'll start with you, Duane, and then we'll let Lauren and Sheriff Paxton answer. As a candidate for sheriff of Forsyth County, how does the Constitution of the U.S. and the Declaration of Independence inform you as to your decision-making process concerning the laws of Georgia and the United States?
And I'll repeat the question.
The Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of Georgia, the question is, how does that inform me?
Yeah, how does that inform your decision making?
That controls absolutely everything we do in law enforcement. Fourth Amendment is what we deal with the most. I don't think I need to do a civics lesson, but this is a law enforcement position. That's what you do. Law enforcement keeps you safe, but they keep you safe by putting bad guys in jail. That is what we do. I'm really not sure what the answer to the question is, so maybe one of them can answer it better. But I want to go back to the horses. They're a wonderful campaign tool. Wonderful campaign tool. People go up and talk to them. They like the pretty horses, and they vote for you. They vote for you because you have horses. What the sheriff just described were some situations that are custom made for bike patrol and for the ATVs, all of which we already own. Bicycles don't eat. ATVs, when they run out of gas, you just put more in them. When they're done, you get another. We have, I'm not sure how many bikes. I think we have 11 or 12 bicycles right now. And last I knew, we had nobody certified to ride them. It's out there riding. Bicycles are cheaper. Bicycles are more effective. They can get places horses can't go, and you're not sneaking up on anybody in a horse. On a horse. They're wonderful campaign tools, and we don't need them.
Thank you. It'll be the same question for you. I'll repeat it. As a candidate for sheriff of Forsyth County, how does the Constitution of the U.S. and the Declaration of Independence inform you as to your decision-making process concerning the laws of Georgia and the United States?
Well, the Constitution is what we're all the base all our principles on. I mean, that's why we're here today. The freedom to gather, the freedom to speak, and of course, it gives us the freedom to vote, something that we'll be doing in July. And I think that without that, we don't have principles. We see even our Supreme Court justice saying that constitutions of other countries are better than ours, and they're not. And I really, truly believe that being a leader of a sheriff's office and abiding by the Constitution is one of the most important things. When you are arresting somebody, you are taking them and putting them in a detention center. Yes, at that time, they are guilty in the deputy's eyes of possibly doing some wrongdoing. But until proven in a court of law, that they are still innocent. And that's one thing that we have is our freedom within our Constitution.
All right, thank you very much. And finally, Sheriff Paxton. I'll read it again.
Sure.
All right, so as a candidate for sheriff of Forsyth County, how does the Constitution of the U.S. and the Declaration of Independence inform you as to your decision-making process concerning the laws of Georgia and the United States?
Thank you. They are the documents that our country was founded on. They are the documents that lead every aspect of what we do in this country. And it is everything that I look at on a daily basis to make sure that we operate and we do everything within the confines of the framework of the Constitution. There are so many things within the Constitution that come into play on a daily basis in operating the Sheriff's Office. Fourth Amendment, search and seizure is one of the most comprehensive things that we deal with on a daily basis. And it goes back to what I talked about earlier. Knowing and realizing and understanding that is why we concentrate so much on training back down to the levels, to the deputies in the field, to make sure that they clearly do understand. The challenge is that Constitution has been interpreted how many times since then by court cases? Ever evolving from day to day, week to week, a new court case which now changes the way that we've been doing it in the past, and so we now have to have the ability to bring everybody back in, retool, and start over again. First Amendment, the right to free speech. Absolutely, here we are, everyone exercising that right, and what a tremendous right it is. And the point being, every one of us in law enforcement are here because we have given an oath that we will protect that right for you. We will give our life for you to protect that right. The Second Amendment, the right to keep and bear arms. There's a lot of discussion about that, but the bottom line is it's in there. And it is a very important principle and doctrine that we have in this country. The bottom line is this. Everything we do within the Sheriff's Office, our policy manual, are all built around the framework of the Constitution, the most dearest document there is. There's not one like it anywhere in this universe except right here in our country. And I'm proud to be able to stand here before you and tell you how much I support that document. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, Duane, this next question is yours. What non-essentials do you feel can be cut from the sheriff's budget?
Did everybody get a copy of what we filled out when we came in? Just read that, please. I don't want to try to take up all that over again. Travel and some other things on there. I want to go back to something that Mr. McDonald said earlier. One of the things that Mr. McDonald, when he announced for sheriff Sunday a week ago in the Forsyth County newspaper, he pointed out a bunch of different groups of people that he wanted to cooperate with in order to make our county government run more smoothly. He mentioned the school board, he mentioned the county commissioners, he mentioned some other groups of people. That's commendable. If your county government is not cooperating together, you're going to have confusion, you're going to have problems, you're going to have money waste. The problem is, he left out possibly the most important group of people that the sheriff's office and the sheriff and his agency have to deal with every single day. He didn't mention anything about our judicial system. He didn't mention the solicitor. He didn't mention the district attorney. He didn't mention any of the judges. This is what I'm talking about. Pay attention to who's running for your offices. Make sure they know what they're getting into. Make sure they know what the imperatives are. We've got a jail we have to run. We've got people that we arrest that we have to do by the Constitution. Pay attention to who's, pay attention to what they're saying, what folks are saying up here. Thank you.
All right, Lauren, why do you believe you will be a better sheriff than the one we have?
Well, I think I have the ability to empower the people to get behind me and to believe in what I want to do as far as the next sheriff of Forsyth County. I have, of course, even in my own personal business, you know, I'm a guy that has to generate revenue. I have to decide how that revenue is going to be managed. Then I have to decide how that revenue is going to be spent. As sheriff, you're given a bucket of money, and all basically you spend it. And I think that we need to have someone that knows what it is to make a payroll, what it is to keep morale up within a business, and to work with people. And that's why I think I would be a better sheriff.
Thank you. I'd like to remind gentlemen, you know, you can use the entire 2 minutes, so feel free to rebut or add on to another question that you might have. Utilize the time. All right, Sheriff Paxton, why did you refuse to answer the debate questions?
Excuse me, I'm sorry. I didn't refuse to answer the debate questions. I just didn't turn them in on time. I think y'all got them out there in the field, so please feel free to read over them. Going back to a little while ago, there was a question that was asked of Mr. McDonald about his decision-making process in the event he were to be faced with a situation where there was a SWAT call out. Let me assure you, that is probably one of the most stressful situations you will get into when you're trying to manage a situation where whether it be a hostage, whether it be someone who has barricaded themselves in a house simply because they don't want to give up, a various number of reasons why we are forced to have to call on the resources of those people who are specially trained. Now, one thing I take pride in is that I've done everything within my power to make sure the people within that unit have got the proper and necessary tools to be able to carry out that duty, and also in the safest manner that we can provide for them. But ultimately, when you're out there, the time is going to come when you've got to make that decision. Is the situation right or not right to where you're now going to force entry into the location? Do you have the proper warrants? Do you have proper knowledge of what's going on inside there? Do you have a situation where we're looking at is a force as far as maybe taking a life? Well, you better be able to make that decision right there at that time and know, once again, what the conditions and the restraints are on the Constitution, what the authority is vested in you as the chief law enforcement officer, of where can you go to and what can you do and what is the right time to do it. And ladies and gentlemen, it's not a time to get a committee and start asking what should I do.
Amen. Thank you, Sheriff.
If anyone else has questions, I've got the cards now. Hopefully you'll have a time.
All right, Duane, next question is yours. Why do you believe you will be a better sheriff than the one we have now?
This will give me an opportunity to talk about something I forgot to talk about in my opening. My background. I've been a 25-year law enforcement professional since after getting out of the Army in 4 years. In that time, I worked in patrol division, criminal investigation division, narcotics, the jail, SWAT, internal affairs. I've worked virtually every aspect of law enforcement. Not only have I worked every aspect of law enforcement, I've also supervised and managed in those same areas. I happen to know that Mr. Paxton's background wasn't quite that broad before he took over. and he's so far removed from the top of the agency, I don't think he has the same ability to connect with all of his employees at the level where not only has he done their jobs, but he's also supervised and managed people doing the same jobs. That would be one of the reasons. Oh, sorry, I thought you were raising your hand or something. Thank you.
All right, Lauren, what non-essentials do you feel can be cut from the sheriff's budget?
I too feel that they're the non-essentials, starting with the horse patrol. I think that is something that I hear, not this isn't coming from hearing another candidate, this is hearing it from the deputies. I feel that they see think it's a waste of money. Also, I think that in the top management positions, there could be some cutting there to move that money from management back on the streets of Forsyth County and to protect and serve our community.
Thank you. All right, gentlemen, this next question will be for all three of you. We'll start with Sheriff Paxton. Briefly describe your familiarity with Agenda 21, and are you prepared to defend property rights of citizens from federal government and bureaucracies?
Okay, well, obviously I'm like a fool of myself. Somebody explain Agenda 21 to me. All right, I don't have any idea what Agenda 21 is. Repeat the rest of the question, please.
I'll try to give you a little bit of background. So, Agenda 21 was an initiative that was started by the UN. George Bush actually signed the treaty. It's never been ratified, but what we're seeing in this country is that it's being pushed at the local level. And it manages what they call smart growth. What's the other term?
Sustainable growth.
So these are the terms that they use. And essentially what it is it allows communities, local communities, to cede responsibility and ownership of properties and control of their land to a greater body beyond the United States. So in a nutshell, that's what it is. And the reason the question's asked, I think, is because people feel that the final safety for communities is going to be the sheriff's office. It's the one position that people feel could push back on something like this.
Does that come out of this meeting?
No.
I won't take my whole 2 minutes. Don't worry. Everything you just said, I'm adamantly opposed to. I mean, there's one of the most basic principles we have in this country is the right to own property. And once we own that property, it is ours to do as we please, as long as it is within the confines of whatever particular zoning issues there may be around. If you live in a subdivision, whatever restrictions you may have to a homeowners association. But the bottom line, I'm a strong proponent of that. And so I would do everything within my power here locally to impact whatever is done on a national, international level. Unfortunately, if it ever were to become law, whoever is sheriff is going to find themselves in a dilemma. Because the sheriff is under an oath to enforce the laws of the state of Georgia and to uphold. So it certainly be a dilemma, but I certainly hope and I anticipate that there will be more sound minds will prevail here, and then we would truly not see that type of agenda passed and come down the pike to us.
Thank you.
My understanding of Agenda 21 is that it was a UN resolution that's infiltrated all the way down into the local government, and they use innocuous sounding names like smart growth, sustainable energy. They use all these kind of things to make you feel good about it. There shouldn't be much of a dilemma. This is what I was talking about if I didn't explain myself well enough earlier. They're constitutional imperatives. Both the US Constitution and Georgia Constitution, there are constitutional imperatives placed on the sheriff. He's here to defend
all the right, not, he should not only enforce laws, but to defend all the rights of the people. He needs to know what he's defending. He needs to know what he can do. He needs to know what he's supposed to do according to the Constitution.
Thank you, Wayne.
Well, wow, what a tough question. As important as it is, we've all dealt with condemnation issues. I mean, we've seen when power lines are going to go through somebody's property, and of course government takes somebody's property, and we have to believe that it is not the right of government to come in and take one's property. And I think that we, as a constitutional officer, should defend that right to the letter of the law. And I think that it's important that the next sheriff understand that when, if put in that position, that he has to obey and defend the people of this community.
Thank you. All right, this is another question for all of you, and we'll start with Sheriff Paxton. If elected, what would be your plan to utilize local resources? For example, certain community emergency response teams, VIPs, or volunteers in police service, or other volunteer positions?
We already access every possible means of utilizing volunteers throughout the community. We put in place several years ago a program called CERT, Citizens Emergency Response Teams. We've had quite a number of people have gone through that training with us in conjunction with the Emergency Management Agency here in the county. And once again, it is to empower people throughout the community in case of any type of a disaster, whether it be man-made or natural, that until emergency help can get to them, for example, God forbid if we were to have a tornado, and in one particular part of the community is now blocked off by down the trees, power lines, and it's going to take a little while to get equipment in place to get that out of the way to where we can get in with first responders. Well, what we've done is take these people throughout the community, these CERT members, and given them basic training and techniques of how to at least survive, hopefully help their neighbors, organize, keep some type of order to where till they can kind of keep things going until we can get there. So it would be my commitment to continue to expand on that program as we move on down the road and hopefully be able to empower everyone in a volunteer position if we can to utilize them not only at the sheriff's office but out there. We have had over the years several times too to where we've had volunteers, retired people have come into the sheriff's office and just actually helped out answering phones, doing some filing and paperwork. We're open to everybody wanting to come in the door and help us out. Thank you.
You want me to repeat the question?
I think one of the best of the CERT program has been commendable in the county. I think the sheriff's office and the staff has done a great job getting into the subdivisions and our community to put together a program that does have investment from the citizens. Another good resource is mutual aid. I think that having great relationships with our neighbors is also imperative when we get placed in these situations, that we train with them, that we work with them. We're very fortunate in this community to have a great 911 center and also a great EMA center up at our headquarters up off Setting Down Road. It is a great tool for when and if this situation might happen. And I think that it's an investment that everybody in this room has made. I mean, it's not something that one agency has put together and said it's mine. It is an investment from fire, from sheriff's office, from the commissioners to make sure that each of us are safe if something ever happens in this community.
Thank you. Duane.
All of the different community volunteer groups are extremely important. It's one of the ways that your law enforcement agency stays in contact and interacts with the public. Keeps the public interested in what we're doing, keeps them aware of what we need to accomplish, and we get ideas from them. One of our best resources that we have right now is our community policing unit. I see Dr. Cardella back there.
If there's any of the rest of you in here and I missed you, I'm sorry. That's a very effective unit populated by people that enjoy their jobs and are very good at their jobs. It's being slightly misused right now. We'll change the location of it, put that under patrol, where they can have a better response, where we're not doing so much of a show for y'all. We're actually accomplishing something with those people. Right now, the procedure is, say, a precinct captain or a block captain sends an email to the community policing unit. Community policing unit will answer you, and they'll send it on out to other people. Might get paid attention to, might not get paid attention to. We're going to take that unit. We're not doing away with that unit. That unit's staying. If anything, we'll strengthen that unit. That unit would go under uniform patrol. When you send an email in where you have a situation where you don't necessarily want to dial 911, you don't think you want to bother the police right there, you send that email, the same email you get, same email you would send right now, and on the next shift, the police officer that works your area will come to your house. See what you can do to help you solve that problem. And by the way, you will have the same officer shift after shift after shift. Right now, we're changing shifts. The people that work your areas, your zones, change every 2 or 3 months. They can't get to know anybody. They don't know who's coming, who's going. They don't know which husband works out of town, gone for weeks at a time, and the wife and kids are home alone. They don't know that. We're going to change our entire concept of patrolling, make it safer. We'll actually know you. We'll let you get to know us. I'm done.
Okay, Sheriff Paxton, next one for you. It's been proposed a proposal's been made to start a holding a firearms instruction class. This will help teach safety and gun laws to our citizens. This class could be offered by the sheriff's office. Would you support this type of class?
I certainly would support that type of a class, but I'm getting all kinds of questions here that people are angry about the amount of money that we spend, but they want us to spend more money. I mean, there are private gun clubs out here in the community. There are private gun ranges that have absolute certified instructors that people can go to and access and be taught on how to properly handle a firearm. That is certainly one of our constitutional rights, and I support that, but I also encourage everyone, if you're going to do that and have a firearm and you've never had one before, please do not do it until you go and seek out proper training and how it operates, because there's nothing more dangerous than getting hold of a weapon and not knowing how it works. I'd like to follow back just a minute on Mr. Piper's comments. I think we were talking about volunteers. Captain Cardell is in the back here. He is not charged with community relations units. He's in charge of the reserve unit of the sheriff's office. Reserve unit made up of volunteer deputies in the community, people who are certified peace officers who have other careers and other jobs, but they volunteer their time to come in and work at the sheriff's office. And thank you all so much, and we continue to expand on that program. We have a great community relations unit. I'm very proud of the work they do. Over the last, since 04, we've been able to expand the Neighborhood Watch program in Forsyth County to where we had just over 25 subdivisions actively participating in Neighborhood Watch. To today, we've got over 300 that are actively participating in Neighborhood Watch. And I dare say there's some of you in this audience right here tonight that have interacted with those deputies that work in that Neighborhood Watch program and how they have paid off, how it has worked, how involved in the community out in subdivision, and the work they do in educating people. Thank you.
Okay, Duane, what would your standards be on physical fitness?
If you can't go 10 miles, don't apply. We would introduce some physical fitness standards. Right now, we don't have any. I think they're necessary. There would be minimal. You don't have to be a trained athlete. But the nature of our job is unfortunately, on occasion, we have to persuade people to do something they don't want to do. And most often, those people are motivated, whether by they've just done something wrong, they may be under the influence of something, but they're motivated not to want to do what we have to make them do. If you're not, if you don't have a minimum physical fitness, what good are we to you? If we have people that come to you and they, how many of you have been in a physical fight any time in the last 5, 10, 15 years? Fighting will take it out of you. 5 or 10 seconds of really hard fighting is going to make your heart beat hard. If you send somebody to you that's going to have a heart attack from that 5, 10, 15 seconds of exertion, we're not doing you any good. So yes, there will be minimum physical fitness standards, and we won't be walking in, doing them the next day, and everybody doesn't pass them fired. They'll be phased in. We'll do it legally, we'll do it properly, and we'll assist the people that are already there in making those standards. We're not trying to get rid of anybody with those. We're going to serve the public better with them. Thank you.
Okay, Lauren. If elected sheriff, would you continue to post mugshots online of persons convicted of misdemeanors which have been adjudicated, where it appears at the top of the search results years after the misdemeanor has been adjudicated?
Well, as far as the search results, I really do not know much about it, so I'm not inclined to answer that question. So I'm going to take mine back to kind of a fit for duty question. I think it's important physically and mentally to be fit. I think that as a fireman of 24 years, that's something that was required every year, that we go through a program to make sure that we're fit. And it's not fit so that you're protecting yourself. It's also protecting your partner and protecting the citizens. And I think that is very important, that it helps everyone mentally, because a fit body has a fit mind. And I think it would be important to establish that, to make the deputies feel good about themselves and feel good about coming to work every day.
Thank you. All right, this next one is again for all three candidates. Last week, and we'll start with Sheriff Paxton. Last week, Pat Robertson, former presidential candidate and spokespastor of the 700 Club, stated he supported the legalization of marijuana and the end of prohibition on marijuana. 14 states have legalized marijuana. How would you respond to an end to the failed war on drugs if Georgia legalized marijuana?
I absolutely would not support the legalization of marijuana. I know that there is a lot of discussion about it being a personal choice, but the bottom line is that we've seen throughout the community and the country how that marijuana is now the stepping stone into the next arena of what type of a drug that the person is now going to go to. So it is not something that we need to really, in my opinion, even discuss. Now, there is a tremendous amount of people on the one side who would argue that, I guess it's very simple, if marijuana and other drugs are made legal, then therefore we don't have a drug problem, right? I mean, that's kind of like the argument they want to put out there. Well, that's wrong, because number one, there's so many associated things that go along with that. The addiction of the particular drug, starting with marijuana, we typically see it escalates into that. Well, then you talk about it being a personal choice. Okay, so if the person wants to ingest drugs into their body, that's their choice. The problem is, there's all type of associated problems that go along with it now. The decimation of the family unit, where they'll steal anything in the household so they can get the money now to go buy the next hit of whatever it is. Burglaries, because they're out there stealing your property, trying to steal your property so that they can go get the money for it to buy the next hit of drugs.
armed robberies. I can go on and on and on because you see what I'm talking about. Then you get into the turf wars about all the drugs and it continues to escalate. And so even at the rate of marijuana, as low as it is, that is not a place to be messing with it. It has got to remain unlawful as far as I'm concerned. Thank you.
No, I'm not for legalizing any drugs. Much like Sheriff Paxton, I've seen the impact it has on families. I've seen the impact it has on crime rates. Actually, our crime rates are driven by alcohol and drugs. Pretty much every crime you go to is going to involve alcohol or drugs. I do, however, understand what Mr. Robertson was talking about. Was it just marijuana he was talking about, or he talked about all drugs?
No, it was marijuana.
Just marijuana specifically? I've heard people that advocate legalizing it. I think what their reasoning for, and I would hope that his reasoning was, to tax it so you can assist.
The question didn't provide reasoning.
Okay. But that kind of takes us into another thing. There's other ways to cut down on costs and cut down on incarceration. We really need to decriminalize a little bit of some of the behaviors that we're criminalizing right this minute, especially when it comes to kids, young kids. I specifically remember growing up. It was fun. You get those hormones running through your body, you do all kinds of stuff, you don't even know why you did it 5 minutes later. And right now, we're saddling, especially once they hit 17-year-old age, we're saddling kids with criminal records that are going to follow them through the rest of their lives. They may make a mistake someplace, and they lose a college scholarship because of something stupid they did when they're 17 years old. There's other ways we can handle stuff like that. We don't have to make a kid part of the criminal justice system because he makes a mistake. Does he have to pay for that mistake? Absolutely, he's got to pay for that mistake. Does he need to learn from it? He better, or next time he's going to jail. But we can introduce some problems, and here we are back to working with the judicial system, back to working with the district attorney's office, back to working with the solicitor's office, Let's get where we can help these kids out. Let's teach them something, make them pay a price, but not criminalize it for the rest of their life. Not criminalize them for the rest of their life. Don't take a scholarship away from a kid for mistake.
Unfortunately, you know, I'm kind of embarrassed. Pat Robinson went to the same high school as I did, and so I'm not happy about some decisions that he's wanting to place upon us. But, you know, I'm too against the legalization of marijuana. I see what it's doing in our community, even the synthetic marijuana that's being sold out there. Kids don't understand the dangers of doing it, and it's easy for them to get. You know, I hope to make a better impact on the teenagers having access to that. You know, drugs are dangerous, and drugs are prevalent in our community, and we need to do a better job to educate our kids on just what they said. I mean, it starts with marijuana, then it goes to the next level, and the decisions that one may make while under, whether it's just marijuana, can impact them for the rest of their life, decisions that might even affect another individual. And so, you know, I think that we as citizens have got to do our part to educate our kids and let them know the dangers that the drugs are to them.
Thank you, Warren. All right, Sheriff Paxton, how many patrol cars are taken out of the county on a regular basis? Officers taken in home, et cetera, and how would we regulate this?
Okay, patrol cars. I guess first of all, you have to understand it's kind of open-ended, a patrol car. Okay, every car we got can be on patrol at one time or another. Okay, used to that. But the cars that are assigned to the uniform division out in the precincts, the only ones that are driven, they're not driven out of the county. The ones that are taken home is, we don't have cars that deputies are assigned cars to take home. We don't have enough. But what it is, if it's on their shift, what we've got is one car is assigned to two people. So on If it's their shift working, for example, people that came to work this morning at 7 o'clock, they've got to work today and tomorrow. So they would drive that car during the day. Tonight, they would drive it home, bring it back in the morning, and then turn it in tomorrow night. The point being is that added exposure out here in the community somewhere serves as a deterrent for crime. Now, yeah, there are time to time when we do have cars that are marked patrol cars that are taken out of the county. The decision is based on, is it beneficial to the sheriff's office and to Forsyth County for that car to be taken out? Those cars are typically assigned to people that are on the SWAT team. They have to live, they still have to live within 25 miles of the county line. But beyond that, their effectiveness is not going to be utilized. Therefore, they're not allowed to take the car home because, once again, it's back to what I said. Is it a benefit to the county and a benefit to the sheriff's office for them to take the car? Obviously, at 2 o'clock in the morning, we have an event happen, and the SWAT team has to be called out. They've got to be able to respond quickly and get there with the necessary equipment that they've got to use. Needless to say, from time to time, we'll have transports. We've got one of the things we're tasked with is having to move prisoners all around the state, go pick them up, move them from jail to jail. They schedule these things, so hypothetically, this has happened. We have a deputy that's working in transport, and tomorrow he's got to make a pickup over somewhere in East Georgia. All right, and he happens to live up across the line over in Gwinnett County. Well, yeah, we'll let him take the car home so he can get in his car in the morning and keep going east to go over there and make that prisoner pickup in the morning, rather than him having to come in from home, drive all the way back here, get the car, and still put the same number of miles on the car that's going to be put on it regardless. I'd like to go back, if I could, just for a moment. We were talking about, Mr. Piper was talking about physical fitness. We do have minimal standards. But one of the things you've got to remember is that those standards have to have a bona fide occupational qualification for them. And it also is very incumbent that we are...
You got 10 seconds.
You threw up the red one.
That's a 10 second one.
We got to make sure that any condition you place on employees is in line with employee law and that can it be enforced. And I'm not familiar with any situation out here where we had a deputy who wasn't able to do their job because of some physical problem ahead. Thank you.
All right, Duane, other than better management and saving money, what other plans do you have to improve the department?
Question. I'll go back to some of the criminalization. Then we can cut down. That way, we can cut down incarceration, number of people in jail, and how much we're paying. Mental health courts. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the drug court that Judge Bagley runs. It's an extremely successful program. People that are charged with nonviolent drug crimes, narcotics type crimes, with no weapons involved, can go through a treatment program. Takes them anywhere from a year to 3 years to get through it. Once they do that, their record's clean. If they do it successfully, their record's cleaned off. And that's been so successful here in Forsyth County and other counties that as my understanding, the state is actually trying to take that statewide as the standard. We can do the same type of thing with mental health. There are mental health courts running. Work with our court systems, once again. On mental health courts, we have some advocates here in the area that they're actually trying to work with the courts right now. That would be one of the things. Broad question. I'll stop there.
Lauren, what are your plans to retain highly qualified officers and also attract new highly qualified officers to this department?
I think retention is directly related to pay. I think that our deputies, we need to work with our Department of Human Resources and within the county and get the deputies' pay up. I think that, you know, of course, everybody would love a pension. Right now, I could not promise a pension to the deputies because this economic environment, we cannot afford it. But, you know, I think that we need to have a standard of so that when deputies want advancement within their ranks, that there is a, there's a, something that will be done so that their pay could be better. So that's what I'd like to do.
Thank you. All right, for Sheriff Paxton, you said you bought over 100 vehicles with drug seizure money, and you currently have 80 some of those vehicles in service. What happened to the other vehicles purchased?
They were simply decommissioned because they broke down. That happened, you know, over the last 11 plus years. So those 22 were decommissioned and they're not out there anymore. I'd like to comment on Mr. Piper's talking about decriminalization of certain things out here in the community. Well, the sheriff is not a part of the legislative branch. The sheriff is the enforcer of the law. The state legislature is the one that decides what the law is, and it is the sheriff's responsibility and duty to enforce the law. Yeah, there's a lot of programs, there's a lot of things going on down right now in the legislature. If anybody's taking a note about some revamping of our criminal justice system here, but the bottom line is the sheriff is going to have to do what comes out of the state legislature. That's what we do, is enforce. We do not legislate law. That is not part of the charge of the office of sheriff, is that. So even though there is talk about decriminalization, there are some things I will express with you that I certainly have my own personal beliefs about maybe they should be done differently. But bottom line, that can now come into play with your sworn duty that you are to enforce the laws of the state of Georgia. Yeah, there's a lot of talk and has been a lot of talk over the years about the problems with mental health and the numbers of people that we have in jails throughout this state that really don't belong there, that the underlying problem is mental health. But until the state legislature does something about it, we're still confined with where we are right now. And I assure you, the Georgia Sheriff's Association for years has been working with the state legislature to try to find a solution to that problem. Thank you.
All right, this next question is for all the candidates. We're going to start with Duane. Explain your understanding of community policing, and will you introduce it or continue it?
Community policing is a concept that came into law enforcement, I believe in the late 80s, the first time I heard about it. Somewhere in the 80s. The concept is that all officers work a specific area, get to know the business people, get to know the people that live in those areas. They actually get to know their community, and the community gets to know their officers. The purpose is, what I said earlier, the purpose is so that he can more effectively fight crime and more effectively keep you safe, because he knows what goes on within his area. We claim to do it right now. We don't do a very good job. That will be the model we're going to. It's more effective. It cuts down on, it just helps with everything all the way around. I'm going to change to something else though. School resource officers. Another thing I do to help improve what we're doing. A couple years ago there was some type of budget dispute that I'm still not completely sure of. But we took a significant number of officers, school resource officers, out of the schools. We're going to put those back in. If the school board will work with us and will allow us to, I don't care if we got to pay for all of ourselves. We're going to put a school resource officer in every single high school and every single middle school. Every one of those school resource officers is worth two officers on the street. They know the kids, they know the administrators, they know the teachers, they know the rules. They're like another older brother or sister or parent at school. They know what's going on with the kids. They know who hangs around with who. They know who's dating who. When we have a problem with kids going on, the school resource officers are valuable. They're not nearly as valuable when you've got one school resource officer trying to work multiple schools. He loses effectiveness. That's too many kids to keep up with, and he gets confused from school to school. We are going to put those back in there, and we'll work with the school board however we need to do that.
Thank you. I'll repeat the question. Explain your understanding of community policing, and will you introduce it or continue it?
I will continue it. I think we're, you know, I think we do a decent job at community policing. I think, you know, with the different subdivision CERT programs that are going on within our community, I get the emails. We have it going on in my subdivision. I see around the town, you have the businesses have taken a part in it so that they are recognized as businesses that do care about what's going on in the sheriff's department. So I think it's a good program that we will continue within the office. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll definitely continue what's been a successful program. It's worked great. As I said, we've implemented it many years ago. We have a very strong community relations unit that relays information out to the community. And once again, I challenge, as Mr. McDonald said, I'm sure there's plenty of you out here that live in subdivisions to participate in Neighborhood Watch. And it is our goal to make sure that we let you know out there what is going on, what you need to be on the lookout for, what is happening. And we have a lot of pride in the way that organization, that unit, has come about and what we've been able to provide back to the community. It's very important, yes, for the deputies to understand and know the community, the zones that they're working in. Not really sure where they're getting moved to every couple of months. I mean, they're assigned to the precincts and that's where they're at, unless they get promoted or transferred like to CID if they put in for a transfer. We go out, Community Relations Unit goes out and has Neighborhood Watch meetings, and once again, I'm sure you've all seen, typically the deputy working in that area will actually come by there for a few minutes and introduce himself to the people there at the clubhouse. So yeah, they're vested in the community. They know what's going on in the community. And apparently it works. I mean, from 2006 to now, we're still running at a 25% decline in property crimes. So it must be working. It must be working. School resource officers, it is a great program. That's why we do have one deputy full-time on every high school campus in the schools. Then we have other deputies that are mixed throughout the middle schools. And what we have in place is exactly what the Board of Education has worked with us and identified the level of what they want to have in the schools. Thank you.
Duane, what are your plans to retain highly qualified officers and also attract new highly qualified officers to this department?
One of the most important things we've got to do there is a retirement program, a viable retirement program of some type for public safety officers. For the same reason we have physical fitness standards, there are only certain things that you can do past a certain age. We are here to protect the public. We're here to protect you. We're here to enforce laws. Once you get past a certain age, you just can't do that anymore. To attract good quality people and keep them here, You've got to give them some mechanism where they can go on with life after about 50, 55 years old. There's no way around that, and that is actually why we lose the majority of the people we lose. We lose some of our best and brightest, and they take off simply because we don't have a retirement. We do have a 401k that's been diminished pretty badly over the last few years with the housing bubble. That'd be the most important thing we do. The Sheriff's Lobby is one of the most powerful lobbies in Georgia. The Sheriff's Lobby can be used to influence things like hurry up with the mental health courts. The Sheriff's Lobby can influence a whole lot of things if they will focus on those types of things. I changed gears in case you didn't catch that. I would ask that our sheriffs use their lobby a little bit more powerfully. Reduction in crime since 2006, it has gone down. If you notice, the housing bubble, our economy crashed right about that. We had a little bit of a burst. I actually work in criminal investigations while I was here, so I saw the crime start going down. Once everything was stolen, once all the houses under construction were cleaned out, once all the copper was gone, once the air conditioners were all stolen, once they had no more windows in them,
Yeah, they stopped stealing stuff. They couldn't carry the whole house off, so they stopped stealing stuff. There's a significant reduction in crime, but there's a good reason for it. Thank you.
All right, this next one's for all three. We're going to start with Lauren. What role do ethics and morality play in the leadership of the sheriff's office?
I think it's one of the most important things as the sheriff. I mean, you are the leader of, especially in this Forsyth County, 370 deputies and employees. They look up to you to lead them each and every day, and when you're out in the community, they represent you. When they're riding around, they want to be proud of their sheriff and who the citizens as yourself have elected. I established that at my home with my kids. I teach them about ethics and being moral. It starts at home, and I think that the sheriff needs to have the same responsibility as a parent out there, because you are with your deputies. I mean, you're in charge. You have to be their role model and leader in the community, because they're out there going in the businesses or in the subdivisions. They want to say, hey, my boss is ethically and moral, and I think that's very important. Thank you.
Ethics and morality are exactly what guide all of us each day in what we do. Ethics and morality is obviously built into the operation of the sheriff's office. It is a benchmark of the policies which we have in place. People are held to those standards. It is what we're all about, ethics and morality. So I certainly support that, and we have been supporting it and will continue to support it. I'd like to touch on a couple of things Mr. Piper said about pension and pay. We've heard that about retaining employees, and kind of funny, they both got asked a question, but not me. There's nothing going on in the sheriff's office that is not impacting every agency out here, and that is people leave for more money. Bottom line, they leave for more money, and we have over the years become a training ground for other agencies, because we're not able to compete with the creations of the cities of Milton, the cities of Johns Creek, who start off paying them tremendous amounts of money and taking them from us here. The bottom line is, I'd love for them to have a pension system. I'd love for them to have more money. That can only be granted by the governing authority of the county, the Board of Commissioners, not the sheriff. I support it, do everything I can, but once again, that's something that sits within the purview of the governing authority of the county. I'm trying to understand how it is that apparently nothing the sheriff's office does impacts crime in the community. It's because the economy went down and there's nothing else here to steal? It must be a barren, vast wasteland out there of gutted homes in the community, in the county, because I'm trying to understand what that one's all about. Thank you.
Sure. What role do ethics and morality play in the leadership of the sheriff's office?
Ethics and morality are the most important thing in leadership of the sheriff's office. They're the cornerstone of leadership. Anybody, especially in a law enforcement type, law enforcement is paramilitary. We can't escape that. Law enforcement is a paramilitary organization. Especially in situations where you can have extremely stressful, sometimes physically dangerous situations, leadership's essential. Stability in leadership is the most important thing. Because this is when it should be assumed that the people at the higher level you go, the stronger that person is. The people at lower levels are automatically assumed to be looking to the strength of those above them. If you don't have people that can look up and see somebody stronger than them, they lose confidence. When they lose confidence, they don't perform as well, and the situation can get dangerous. Ethics and morality is the cornerstone of that. Your people have to see as ethical and moral.
in order for leadership. I want to help some folks understand crime rates. We have other crime, other than just stealing things. I was responding to something the sheriff said in regards to property crime reduction. Overall crime rates, you people are the ones responsible. The folks that live here, the people that live in Forsyth County, are actually the ones responsible for the low crime rate that we've enjoyed for the last 50 years. The crime rate has been low in Forsyth County. It was low when I moved here, and it's still low. Crime rates are driven by people committing crimes. If your population is not likely to commit crimes, you're not going to have a lot of crimes. Is law enforcement important? Absolutely, it's important. We need to impact what we can impact, and we need to immediately arrest people that commit the crimes. We do that. But we can do it for a whole lot less.
That's 2 minutes. All right, the next question is for Lauren. Would you be willing to attend the state, and I apologize here, I think it's advancement, to become post-certified?
Yes, very much so. I'm in my personal business, have a staff that the reason I'm doing this today is I can entrust them to run it. I have a wife that is there and going to take my place in my personal business. And I'm not going to try to lead a group of people without having the same certification as they have. So immediately, that's something, if elected sheriff, that I would do.
Thank you. All right, this will be the last question. It'll be for all three of you gentlemen. We'll start with Sheriff Paxton. What is the statutory authority for the 10% add-on to the bonds at the jail?
You'll have to, I can't quote the code section, I don't have it in front of me, but there is a statutory authority that says that there is a 10% add-on to bonds, people bonding out of jail, that goes into an account which is regulated by the governing authority on what those funds can be spent on. And they typically have to be spent on some particular thing that is beneficial to the people in the operation of the jail. One of the things that it got used for recently was when a new computer program was put in place at the courthouse. There needed to be software developed that would cause our system and their system to communicate. And so that's where the funds came from, was from that particular account. Now, I don't want to keep getting hung up on this one about the crime, but yeah, we've got a safe community. And it is in part due to that we have people, a lot of people here that don't commit crimes. But the fact of the matter is the criminal element throughout Metro Atlanta is very, very mobile. And to suggest that the only reason that crime is down in Forsyth County is because no criminal lives here, I don't understand that one, because ladies and gentlemen, let me assure you, criminals are like water. They will take the path of least resistance. So you better have a force here for the resistance to keep them away. Thank you.
A specific statute either. I'm quite sure that Sheriff Paxton is doing it legally. I'm going to go back to the retirement, the retention of quality employees. We can't afford that if we cut our budget. If we start working smarter, we spend less of your money, we get closer to what Hall County and Cherokee County are spending on their agencies, yes, we can get the retirement going. A lot of our command staff enjoy retirements. Not seeing a whole lot of effort out of them to get your deputies, the ones that are out here protecting you. We have not seen a lot of effort out of our command staff, who most of them are enjoying retirements from other places, to get retirements for the deputies that work here. You want to improve morale? Give them something to work for. Don't have your best and brightest constantly looking for someplace else to go. Let's keep them here. Thank you.
I just want to reiterate what he said. I'm sure the sheriff is using that money properly.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. Those are all the questions that we have, at least the time that we have for questions. And there's plenty more, but. I want to remind everybody that we're passing around both a basket and a jar for donations, and we appreciate anything that anybody could provide for us. Because again, you know, that helps us keep things like this going, to keep the community educated. So we appreciate any help there. Now we're going to have closings from each of the gentlemen here. I'm just going to go in the order that I've been asking questions. You'll have 3 minutes, so we'll start with Sheriff Paxton.
I hate talking into a microphone, and if somebody can't hear me, please speak up and I'll yell louder, okay? Bottom line, it's been a pleasure to be here tonight. We've all got questions we want to know, we're interested in, about how government works, how that we serve you in the community, and I appreciate you being here. We've heard a lot of discussion tonight about the budget. Ladies and gentlemen, understand that the budget of the sheriff's office is basically nothing more than what it takes to pay the employees of the sheriff's office to operate the jail, which is mandated by the sheriff's office, and to pay the bills of the things we have to have. Yes, the budget in Hall County is different. The budget in Cherokee County is different. Before you start making those comparisons, be sure you are comparing apples and apples and oranges and oranges. Those entities have different ways of showing their internal accounting. There are things that are in the budget of the Cherokee Sheriff's Office that we don't do over here. There's things in our budget we do here they don't do. The same over in Hall County. So if you're going to go down that road, please do. I encourage you. Understand the difference between fact and campaign rhetoric. Go get the documents and compare apples and apples and oranges and oranges. My passion is this job. I have done it for 40 years. I've educated myself. I seek every opportunity I can to get more training and education to be sure that I'm on the cutting edge to be able to provide back to the people in this community what I'm hired to do, and that is protect you and keep you safe. And by golly, I think we do an excellent job of it. In closing, I was surprised to hear Mr. Piper use the words of one of the persons I'm sure in this room that we can all look forward to, up to. It's one of his favorite words. Yes, we can. And I don't want to hear any more of his yes, we can. Thank you.
Say yes, we can.
Yeah, I wrote it down. You said.
I apologize. It wasn't meant like that. In closing, I'm just going to go back to what I said in opening. Look at your candidates. Look what they're saying. Look at their records. Sarah's been here for 11 years. Look at his record. Our budget has gone from roughly $12.5-13 million. In 2001, when he took over, to $37.5 million now. That's a huge increase. That drives our tax rate. That's 41%. Look at your candidates. Pay attention. Please stay involved in this process. Stay involved in the election process. Stay involved in all of your election processes. Look at your county commission races. Look at your sheriff's race. This is our government. When the constitutions were written, they were written for the government to serve us, not us serve the government. Serve the government. Pay attention to who you're electing. Thank you.
Again, I want to remind each of you that I'm not a career law enforcement officer. I've never arrested anyone. I do promise that I will run an office with the most ethical and moral standards that will make the citizens of Forsyth County proud. We together can reduce the budget, ensure our parents and our kids that they are safe in school, and make Forsyth County Sheriff's employees proud to come to work every day. In closing, I believe in the spirit of elections. Each of you will be able to choose who you think will be best to protect and serve this county for the next 4 years. I believe that I am that person. I want your vote.
Thank you.
All right, thank you very much, and I'd like to extend a thanks to all the candidates for coming out here and taking the time to answer questions. Thank you very much.
I want to thank all of you for coming. This is a great crowd. I apologize for not having a bigger facility. I underestimated, and we'll have a bigger facility for future debates, but a lot of great questions tonight. And I hope you guys all leave with more knowledge than you came with. We've got to reset up the room, so any of you big hockey guys that want to stick around and help set up some tables, I would appreciate your help. And if you can help contribute to our tea party, then it'll help pay for this facility and the newspaper ad that we run every month to notify citizens of our meetings. Thank you. Thanks for coming.